Let's draw the streamline for the case where gamma is exactly equal to 4 pi u r. This time the stagnation points are at pi by 2. Let's see how this picture gets modified. So this is my gamma and this is the stagnation point. This is the stagnation streamline, and of course the circle is also a stagnation streamline. So possibly I should draw this also with a red line, just to show that this is a stagnation streamline. In fact, I could do the same thing over here. So I will mark this also as the stagnation streamline. Okay. Maybe I should broaden it. And then if I draw the rest of the streamlines, they actually go around the body like this. And this one over here, and they straighten out as you go further away. And finally, they would become almost horizontal lines. And the ones here would also straighten out. The sense of the streamline in all these cases now is counterclockwise. Okay? So notice that this is for a very specific case where gamma is exactly equal to 4 pi u r. Now if we try to increase gamma beyond this value, let's try to get a hang of that. So now I am going to get gamma greater than 4 pi u r. Something very interesting happens, and for that we will have to go back to our equations over here. So kindly notice that from the radial velocity being 0, I had two conditions: that my stagnation point should lie either on the surface or the cylinder, or my cosine theta should be 0. So now I will not be able to satisfy this, because this condition I know would lead to sine theta not greater than 1. That's not allowed. So now I would use this condition that the stagnation point actually lies at pi by 2. If I do that, then I can revisit my condition on v theta and try to figure out what happens if I put sine theta equal to 1. Because now my theta naught is pi by 2. So let's do that. So for this condition, my theta naught is exactly equal to pi by 2. And I can calculate my r. So if I look at my equation C, I would get u times 1 plus r square by r naught square, if r naught is the location of my stagnation point, times sine theta, which I will take as 1. This is equal to gamma by 2 pi r naught. Okay. So one can solve for this equation and get the value of r naught. Of course, I am not going to do that, but I am going to show you qualitatively what the streamlines look like. So now let's draw the streamlines for this case. So this is my circular cylinder, and let me draw again the gamma. This is a large gamma now, and my stagnation point is not on the cylinder anymore. In fact, it is somewhere here along the axis of the cylinder on the symmetry plane. And if you do the streamlines, if you calculate them, you would find that actually the streamline would be, this would be the stagnation streamline, almost circular but not quite, and this would be the direction. But then it does something interesting. This would be the complete stagnation streamline, this equation over here. Okay. And if I draw the other streamline, so let me decorate this a little bit. And if I draw the other streamlines, they look rather interesting. In fact, I would have these streamlines here which would just go around the cylinder. So these are closed streamlines. And the direction is as shown here. So they are all going in a counterclockwise manner. But outside this closed streamline region, I get streamlines which look like this. I'm sorry, I'm just drawing a sketch. You can look at the exact pictures in a book. I will also show you some pictures on the computer screen shortly. But I'm just sketching them to give you a fair idea qualitatively. Okay, and far away they would straighten out just like they would straighten out here finally. Okay. So this is when my cylinder is rotating at a very large RPM and I am trying to model it with a large gamma. The fallout is that there is fluid which seems to spin in the direction of the spin of the cylinder, but then far away you get the saddle point and you can see this streamline actually goes like this. Okay. Again, the flow maintains a symmetry with respect to the y-axis, but it has lost symmetry with respect to the x-axis. So it would still incur a zero drag, but there would be a lift force. Let us now try to calculate the pressure distribution on the surface of the cylinder. I will use the Bernoulli's equation. Because this is an irrotational flow, remember even a free vortex is an irrotational flow, however there is a singularity at r equal to 0. So this is an irrotational flow, it is inviscid, incompressible, steady. So I can apply the Bernoulli's equation between any two points in the flow, not necessarily along the streamline. So I will take a point which is far upstream, okay, so I will refer to those as p infinity values and u infinity values, and then I will take a point on the surface of the cylinder. If I do that, I would be able to write the following. So p infinity by rho plus half u square, that is in the free stream, would give me pressure on the surface of the cylinder by rho plus half on the surface of the cylinder v r square plus v theta square. We have already seen that on the surface of the cylinder Vr square is 0. No flow can penetrate the solid body. V theta is something that is following. So V theta is given as minus 2u sine theta plus gamma by 2 pi r. Okay. So we can rearrange this and calculate the pressure. Okay. So I will define Cp as P minus P infinity divided by half rho u square. That's the pressure coefficient. So I can substitute for V theta square. I will get two terms, take the square of that, do some jugglery, and I should be able to get the following expression, which is 1 minus 4 sine square theta, and then some terms which depend on gamma. So twice gamma sine theta by pi u r minus gamma square by 4 pi square u square r square. Notice this is the modification due to gamma. This you would recall is the expression that we got even for a stationary cylinder. Which is without a free vortex. Okay? So now Cp is this value and a modification due to the free vortex. I think this is a good point to recollect where we are. So we are trying to model flow past a spinning cylinder, realizing fully well that it is impossible to do that with a perfectly inviscid model. Okay? Even for a stationary cylinder, if you remember, the velocity on the surface, it actually changes. It is not zero. So the tangential speed is zero at the stagnation points, and it achieves a value of 2 times the free stream at the shoulders of the cylinder, and it varies from the tip to the shoulder. So clearly for a stationary cylinder, there is a slip speed. And now we are trying to model a spinning cylinder. And obviously, again, our tangential speed is not going to be the same as the surface of the cylinder, but it would change, and it does. So this is a model which replicates some of the features of a spinning cylinder. All right, with that in mind, we can now look at the force. So I can talk about the cylinder which is spinning like this, gamma. It's in a uniform flow u. I'm not going to worry about the viscous forces. It's an inviscid flow. There are only pressure forces, and I am interested in the drag on the cylinder and the lift on the cylinder. So these would appear from the integral of the pressure. We will see that the drag will turn out to be 0 because of the fore and aft symmetry. However, the lift is not 0, and we can calculate the lift. So that would be given as integral 0 to 2 pi on the surface of the cylinder minus the pressure on the cylinder. So this I would call R equal to capital R, but at a certain theta, minus P infinity times R sine theta d theta. Calculate the expression. I will not do the arithmetic for you, but the final expression you would get is minus rho u gamma. This is a very famous expression, and in fact there is a theorem called the Blasius theorem by one of the very famous fluid mechanicists, who showed that the way a lift is generated on any body, at least through a potential flow approximation, is only through gamma circulation. So of all the potential flows that you have, the only component that generates lift is circulation. Okay? So if somebody asked you what is the root cause of lift, you can simply say it's the circulation. A cylinder with no circulation generates no lift, and a cylinder with circulation gamma, it generates a lift equal to minus rho u gamma. The minus sign indicates that the lift is in the negative y direction. Let me recall for you what the circulation is. So gamma was given as, by definition, an integral over a curve v dot ds, okay, where the curve C is actually the integral has to be taken in a counterclockwise direction. If I look at a circular cylinder, with a certain gamma on it, I could ask myself, does this represent some kind of a spin in an ad hoc sense? So I just look at the gamma, the circulation, and the question I am asking is, if I had to think of a spinning cylinder, what is the corresponding spin rate? So this I would like to equate to actually a certain omega, and this is r. Now we know that gamma generates an expression like this. Suppose it generates some kind of a v theta, which is constant. Okay. So for a constant v theta, my gamma is given as v theta, if I take it outside, and this is 2 pi r. But then v theta times r, sorry, but v theta is omega times r, if omega is the spin rate. And therefore, I can write my gamma as simply omega times 2 pi times r square, right? So what this tells me is that if I was to get some kind of a correlation between gamma and the spin rate of a cylinder, then this is how they are related for a given hardware. So if I fix the radius of my cylinder and give it a spin, then this is the relationship between circulation and the spin rate. This is an important expression. It is very ad hoc, but it does give us a relationship between the two. Let's see what gamma, what the lift force tells us. So the lift force that we are generating is minus rho u gamma. Let's define CL as the lift coefficient, and that's given as lift divided by half rho u square times the projected area. In this case, we are going to simply take 2 times r, which is the diameter, and a cylinder of unit depth. So it's a two-dimensional cylinder, but then we are going to take a unit depth in the z direction. Plugging that in, I am going to get an expression rho u gamma, these two they cancel out, by rho u square r. Let's substitute for gamma from this expression over here. So I will cancel out this rho, I will cancel out 1 u. So if I substitute for the gamma, then I get minus omega times 2 pi and r square divided by u r. let me cancel out one r, and I will combine this omega times r as with u, and this I can write as minus alpha times 2 pi. So we have already talked about alpha is the non-dimensional rotation rate, which is given as omega r by u. So a model of a spinning cylinder tells us that if alpha is my spin ratio to the free stream speed, then the lift coefficient that it generates is simply minus 2 pi times alpha. And if I had to plot this, then this is the expression I get. So on the x-axis, I plot alpha, which is omega times r by u. And on the y-axis, I will plot cd, and I will also plot cl. You will see cd is 0. There is no drag that the potential flow past a spinning cylinder generates. What about the CL? Well, this is the curve for CL. So CL is given as minus 2 pi times alpha. So I can keep spinning the cylinder harder and I will generate more lift. So in principle, I get a linear distribution of lift with alpha. In fact, this idea is used in airfoils also and in wings, and there we model the flow by a gamma like this. So gamma on the airfoil is actually equal to the negative of the gamma, as we have discussed. By convention, a positive gamma is in the counterclockwise direction, but an airfoil generates a circulation which is in the clockwise direction, thereby it generates a lift. I am not going to go into the details of how an airfoil generates lift, but it suffices to say that just like we have modeled the lift or the vertical force on a cylinder by circulation, it can also explain the lift generated by an airfoil due to circulation. So I hope you have been able to appreciate flow past a spinning cylinder, a model of that. And the force on a spinning cylinder is usually referred to as the Robbins-Magnus force. And this can be used to explain many phenomena. For example, if I take a ping pong ball and it is spinning and there is a flow coming at it, so the ball is, you know, moving to the left, and if I sit on the ball, then it appears that the flow is coming to it, coming at it in the direction shown. Then it would actually experience a force, and that force would be in the downward direction. So therefore, it would curve. So a spinning ball would curve in the direction of the force that is shown. Similarly, if you take a cricket ball, then off spinners and leg spinners, they often use very high rotation rates. So again, the Magnus effect would be very important there. Frisbee. Okay, so when I flip a frisbee, then I spin it, and again it stays aloft
because of a certain Magnus force acting on it.
The swing of a cricket ball is another story, and we will have a lecture on that. That is not because of Magnus effect. That's actually a transition phenomena that is because of the seam, and a laminar to turbulent transition explains that. One last thing before we go to a set of slides, I want to remind you that in this entire flow, the potential flow, if I asked you what is the vorticity omega, which is the curl of the velocity. Because this is the potential flow, the vorticity is 0 everywhere. Okay, it is an irrotational flow. So, it is just 0 everywhere. How then does it generate a circulation? Well, because it has a singularity at r equal to 0. If I took a curve that does not enclose the center, then I would get a 0 circulation around it. Okay? So, this is still an irrotational flow, but it bounds a singularity at r equal to 0. We will stop here and look at some slides.